So now that we understand chair and boat conformations, let's see if we can figure out how a chair conformation converts to a boat conformation. And actually, a boat conformation will turn into yet another chair conformation. So we saw that this would be carbon 1, and then this would be carbon 2, and this would be carbon 3, 4, 5, and 6 in the last video. Let's go ahead and put in a substituent. So let's make a mono-substituted cyclohexane ring, and we're going to put a methyl group going up at carbon 1. So that's my chair conformation for methyl cyclohexane. All right, let's see if we can turn that into a boat conformation. Well, what we're going to do is take the chair conformation on the left and just rotate it a little bit to the left. So this would be carbon 1, this would be carbon 2, 3, 4, 5, and 6. So pretty much all that we did was make carbon 2, 3 horizontal and carbon 5, 6 horizontal. And it's still the same chair conformation like that. So where did the methyl group end up? The methyl group is still right here at carbon 1 going up like that. Now we're going to turn everything into a boat conformation. So again, if you have your molecular model set, this would be the time to use it. This is very hard to draw on a flat sheet of paper. The only way to truly understand it is to do the conversion for yourself. What you're going to do is take this carbon 4 and you're going to pull it up. So carbon 4 will end up right here. And let's go ahead and number the carbons for our boat conformation. So this is carbon 1, this is carbon 2. Those didn't really move. Carbon 3 didn't really is gonna move a little bit. And then this is carbon 4, carbon 5, and carbon 6 now. So this is my boat conformation, which we know is very high in energy. All right, what happened to my methyl group? My methyl group is still right here at carbon 1 like that. Now we're going to go from the boat conformation to the other chair conformation. So to do that, we're going to take carbon 1 now, and we're going to literally pull it down relative to the flat plane of the ring. So carbon 1 is going to go down, so that becomes carbon 1. So let's go ahead and number it, right? This would be carbon 1, this would be carbon 2, 3, 4, 5, and 6. So let's go ahead and make carbon 4 red. It's still up. And let's go ahead and put our methyl group. So our methyl group was right here on carbon 1, so it's going to end up right here when we pull carbon 1 down like that. And then just tilt it a little bit and you get your second chair conformation. So if you tilt it, this is, well, this one right here is carbon 1. And this one right here is carbon 4. So let's go ahead and number our second chair conformation. So if this is carbon 1, this is carbon 2, this is carbon 3, 4, 5, and 6. And what happened to the methyl group? The methyl group is right here. So we've now converted a chair conformation to a boat conformation to another chair conformation. And actually, it would go from like chair to half chair to twist boat to boat to twist boat to half chair to full chair again. But just showing you the main changes here from chair to boat and then from boat to chair. Again, do this with the molecular model set. It's the only way to truly understand it. And what you should take from this is we start with our methyl group up and axial. So this is up and axial. And when we're done at carbon 1, the methyl group is still up relative to the flat plane of the ring, but it is now equatorial. So if you have a substituent that starts axial and your one chair conformation converts into the other chair conformation, it's going to go equatorial. This process is called ring flipping. So this is ring flipping. And some students, this means you just literally flip the ring. That's really not what's happening. You're actually interconverting one chair conformation into another chair conformation. And what would happen if you started off with a substituent equatorial? So let's put a hydrogen at carbon 1 equatorial. Right? And we follow that through. So this would be this hydrogen. This would be, hydrogen would be right here. The hydrogen would be right here. And so you can see it ends up turning axial. Right, so it starts off as equatorial, and then you follow it, it turns out to be axial at this point, but it's still down relative to the flat plane of the ring, if there was one. So we see that it changes from axial to equatorial or equatorial to axial, but it stays up or down relative to the plane, the flat plane of the ring that we saw in the last video. So that is the concept of ring flipping. Let's see if we can practice drawing some cyclohexane chair conformations. And let's look at the chair conformation on the top left, and let's see what we can see with this guy here. So carbon 2, 3, right? We can see that line is parallel with the carbon 5, 6 bond right there. And if we look at carbon 4, 5, right, this line right here, that line is parallel with carbon 1 and 2. And then we also have this line right here between this carbon 3 and 4, right, that's parallel between carbon 1 and 6. So we're trying to go for that pattern, which some students say looks like a little bit like a lightning bolt. So it takes a lot of practice to draw those carbons in that chair conformation. So you need to practice a lot. You need to start off really slowly. So let's see if we can draw one really slowly here. So we're going to start out. It doesn't really matter where you start. It doesn't matter how you draw it. It just takes a lot of practice to get a nice chair conformation. So let's start drawing this very slowly. So something like this. And hopefully we'll end up with a decent chair conformation. Okay, so that looks okay. So it looks a little bit like a lightning bolt. You can see I'm not quite parallel here with my lines. It's a little bit hard to draw on the computer screen here, but you get the idea. So this turns out to be carbon 1, right? This is carbon 1. So we're now going to put in our hydrogens or our bonds. And the way to do it is to start axial. So let's go ahead and start axial. You start up at carbon 1. So this is carbon 1. You're going to start up and then you alternate. So you go down at carbon 2. So down at carbon 2, up at carbon 3, down at carbon 4, up at carbon 5, and then down at carbon 6 like that. You're putting in your equatorial bonds. All right, so you already have one up at carbon 1, so you have to start down at carbon 1. So down at carbon 1, and you alternate. So up at carbon 2, down at carbon 3, up at carbon 4, down at carbon 5, and up at carbon 6. So that's a little bit of what the chair conformation of cyclohexane looks like. And we drew methyl cyclohexane, so we had our methyl group at carbon 1, and we started off with our methyl group being axial like that. So let me go ahead and draw in my methyl group this way. So CH3. We know that this chair is going to interconvert with the other chair. It's going to spend most of its time in the chair conformation since those are the most stable. So let's see if we can draw the second chair. Okay, so let's see if we can. So here's our second chair over here, and once again, you have the same concept with your parallel lines, right? Those two lines are parallel, right? These lines are parallel, and then these lines are parallel. So we have three sets of parallel lines, and again, draw very slowly when you're drawing these. So just draw very slowly and try to get everything drawn properly when you're drawing your chair conformations. Okay, and it's not easy to do. So there's my second chair conformation. And we're going to start with our axial bond. So we know that this is carbon 1 now. We know that this is carbon 1. So I'm going to start down for my axial. I go to carbon 2 and I'm alternating. So I went down, so now I'm going to go up, right? So I went and then down and then up and then down and then up. All right, let's put in equatorial now. So I start at carbon 1. My axial is already down, so I have to go up. So up, and then again, I'm alternating. So up, down, up, down, up, and then down. So not a perfect chair conformation by any means, but you get the idea. So what happened to the methyl group when our methyl cyclohexane molecule underwent a ring flip? So this was carbon 1, and we know that now this is carbon 1, and we just saw that the methyl group is going to go from axial to equatorial. So now our methyl group is over here like that. So now I have two chair conformations. One with the methyl group axial, one with the methyl group equatorial. And which one of those two chair conformations is more stable? Well, let's go ahead and put in some hydrogens here. Let's put in hydrogens on carbon 3 and put a hydrogen on carbon 5. And let's go ahead and put in some hydrogens for this molecule over here. So we'll go like that. And let's think about which one of these two conformations is the most stable. Well, in the first example, all right, we have this big bulky methyl group, which is relatively close to all of these hydrogens. And since the methyl group is bulky, it doesn't like that. It doesn't like to have that much steric hindrance. So this conformation left has a lot of steric hindrance. Whereas on the right, you have your hydrogens interacting, right, axial interactions, but your methyl group is out here to the side. It's not really in the way of any of that stuff. Okay, so it turns out if you have a bulky substituent like a methyl group, you want it to be in the equatorial conformation. You want the methyl group to be equatorial. So this is actually the more stable conformation for methyl cycle hexane. So this on the left has more steric hindrance. So more steric hindrance. So the methyl group in carbon 1 interacting at the 3-5 position. So sometimes you'll see it's called 1-3-diaxial interactions. It's also interacting with the 5, but whatever it is, it's going to give you more steric hindrance with the conformation on the left. So the conformation on the right is more stable. So always put your bulky group equatorial because that puts it the furthest away from different substituents on your ring.